welcome everyone here this evening. We're so pleased and delighted that you're all here, and it's just a real pleasure that I get to introduce our friend, our dear friend and colleague, Julie Cliff.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to say it's great to be here. I really think of Hesperia, not exactly as a second home, but as a place I feel very much at home in. And I have to say, you know, if you don't live in the United States now, you're actually a bit nervous about coming here. You know, the publicity isn't great. I went to work in Mozambique in 1976, and I was part of a solidarity movement. And people often ask me, why did you go there? And at the time, it seemed absolutely logical. You worked in movements like the anti-apartheid movement. You worked to support the liberation movements. And then when they got independence and were trying to build new structures and all the old colonialists had left, then you went there and worked. So I went there as part of the solidarity movement of the time. And I think many people in Hesperian have participated in other solidarity movements. And we were called cooperants. And that meant that we were completely embedded in the Mozambican structures. We didn't have any special function. We just worked for the government. And I think that's very different to much of the current aid to countries. But it was possible because we had a government that welcomed us and that just sent us where they needed us. And, you know, after 40 years, last year, the Minister of Health gave us a reception to celebrate elimination of polio in Mozambique, and I'm on one of the committees. She went around the room trying to say nice things about everybody. And she came to me and she said, oh, Dr. Julie, you're part of the furniture. So there, more or less, that's a little bit of a summary of the trajectories I've taken in different areas. And people are very welcome to ask for more details afterwards. And then I thought in the second half, I'd just give a brief description of some of the things that I'm passionate about. And one of them is the disease Konzo. And I've already spoken about this here. But it's a paralysis caused by eating cassava in conditions of extreme hunger. So I had to investigate an epidemic of that. Soon after I made the switch to public health, I went to investigate the epidemic of hundreds of people paralyzed. And we didn't know what the cause was. And it was overwhelming, but it was also very fascinating because we managed to narrow it down and show that it was cassava. Mm-hmm. So, but I think I've written a chapter about it in this book, thanks to Hesperian, who got me here to work on this book. And in that chapter, I say, yeah, this is my greatest academic success, but it's also my greatest failure, because 30 plus years later, we're still getting people paralyzed in Mozambique with this disease. We're not having the huge epidemics we had many years ago, but they are in the DRC. They're still getting huge numbers of cases. But we shouldn't be getting any cases at all. People should not be getting paralyzed from eating cassava, which is their staple food. So now that I'm now that I'm at this stage of my career, still working on this disease, still trying to prevent it. But also, what about the patients? I've spent my life on this disease. It's a disease that causes permanent paralysis. Mm-hmm. So we've got hundreds and hundreds of people paralyzed in remote areas of Mozambique who haven't been getting any rehab at all. So what I've been trying to do lately, and it's been interesting talking to Sarah about this, is set up rehab programs for the people with CONZO. But we can't just do people with CONZO. You can't go to a community and say, hey, show me the patients with CONZO, they're going to get support. You've obviously got to do all the people with disability in that community. And you can imagine in these remote, poor, rural areas of Mozambique, there are a lot of disabled people who are getting no assistance at all. So that's something I'm passionate about at the moment. But I can't say that we've got a great program. You know, it's a struggle. We're doing very little. But we're at least trying to reach people and give them some support. And I guess this is one of my beefs as an epidemiologist. Because, you know, we go after the diseases. We're also very proud because we do prevention. But we quite often forget the patients. I mean, it's the same with polio. You know, we go to find all the cases of paralysis in a community, but we don't offer any rehab. And I think, you know, it's one of the deficiencies of preventive medicine, that it sometimes forgets the rehab in the rush to find the causes. So that's one thing I'm passionate about. The other thing is, of course, this book, which we adapted in Mozambique. This is the Mozambican version of Where There Is No Doctor. And, you know, this book took us 9 years to do. It always takes longer than you think. But like the original Where There Is No Doctor, I think it's been really well used and appreciated. But one of the many other things that I feel passionate about is our community health worker program. And we've got quite a lot of people here who know Sandy McGonigal. How many people? Yeah, quite a few. Anyway, Sandy's from here and she's worked on the new Mozambican community health worker program. We had a program just after independence, in that first flush of primary health care, to train community health workers, but it didn't last. And partly because we had a war, but also they weren't paid. And so as the kind of political enthusiasm diminished, the program just didn't last. But in 2010 it was regenerated. So now we've got a new program. We've got new community health workers who they're now paid by the health service. So it's a very important, interesting program. And I guess I'd just like to end on this note that one of the things I'm really most passionate about is the Mozambican National Health Service. We have a National Health Service that functions, it doesn't cover all the country, it's got big defects, but it exists as a National Health Service and it's free. People are still trying to defend it despite the efforts of many donors to introduce private medicine and undermine the National Health Service, but it functions.
I'm curious about what sort of regional cooperation there is in the area of public health between Mozambique and the other countries in Southern Africa.
There's not a lot. There's not as much as you might think. There's a bit on collaboration around epidemics. Like if one side of the border has cholera, they'll tell the other side. But I mean, in that period after independence, Tanzania actually sent doctors to work in Mozambique. So there was more collaboration back then, but there's really not very much now.
I'm wondering how much of that has to do with the language. Mm-hmm. Not that many people speak Portuguese. My organization tried to do some work there back in the early 2000s.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really very, very hard.
Yeah.
I think people who spoke English could hardly speak enough to be able to participate in, mm-hmm. in our workshops and so on.
Yeah. No, I think it's got an enormous amount to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
Really
mm-hmm.
has. But also our qualifications aren't accepted in those countries.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Zimbabwe, there are enormous numbers of health personnel have gone there to work. But we haven't had that situation in Mozambique. But a lot of it is to do with the language.
There's an organization called Afrobarometer, and they do all these statistics of different things that are going on
yes.
in Africa. And one of the statistics that I had read was that 70% of Africans get their information from mobile phones now. And I'm wondering how much of that is prevalent in Mozambique. Are people using mobile phones for communication and information?
Yeah, they're using mobile phones a lot. Not so much for information at the moment because data is expensive.
Yeah.
So, but that will come. You know, people are using it more. But it's still expensive. And also, the networks, the further away you get from district capitals, the networks get very slow. So it's hard to access the internet.
I want to go back to your original epidemic, condos?
Comzo, yeah.
Okay. Is cassava related to manioc?
It is manioc.
It is manioc.
Same thing.
Well, that's what why I was kind of curious, because at least in the indigenous areas of Latin America, tropical Latin America, it's part of the culture. They know what to do to prepare the manioc. Why is this not part of the culture there?
Because manioc was introduced to Africa.
Okay.
It's native to Latin America. So it was an introduced crop, and people haven't had the labor or the materials you need or the time to process bitter cassava properly. Whereas in Brazil, they process it really well. And I did a paper a few years ago with somebody called a chemoecologist. And there's a whole profession around chemoecology. But he wrote a beautiful phrase, which I can never repeat properly, but that a crop which in Latin America is perfectly adapted for food processing. When it went to Africa, it was, how do you say, poorly adapted. People didn't know how to process it. And so all over Africa, you've got problems with it.
So can you talk through that a little bit more in terms of also people's awareness of it being a problem and the sort of community mechanisms to, you know, whatever it takes, switching varieties or proper preparation or kind of what the you know, you said that there's been failure in certain respects, but what does the good scenario look like?
Well, people grow bitter cassava that has the high cyanide because it's more pest resistant. You've got cyanide in the root. It's more pest resistant. But also one big factor is that monkeys also eat cassava, so they'll steal it if it's not bitter. But also the bitter cassava is more productive, much more productive than the sweet cassava. So, you know, if you're a peasant and your main worry is hunger, you're going to choose bitter cassava over sweet cassava. So communities don't want to change, but they will change if their life situation gets a bit better. Then they'll change over to sweet. But at the moment, bitter predominates.
Yeah, yeah.
You had mentioned your want to, or the importance of rehabilitation for
yes.
victims. Is it a, and you said it's a complete paralysis?
Yeah.
And it's permanent.
Yeah.
So what would the rehabilitation look like?
It's not complete paralysis.
It's not complete.
It's permanent, but there are degrees.
Okay. And you.
So the degrees are mild, where you can walk without a stick. Moderate when you need support to walk, either one or two steps, and severe when you can't walk.
Okay. So it specifically targets the legs?
Yes, yes. Okay. Although you get signs in the arms as well, but it's the legs that are really affected.
And so what kinds of therapies or rehabilitation can there be in the community?
Well, it's hard, and I was just discussing this today, because what they want to, what my physio colleagues want to do, they want to set up centres in the worst affected areas where you teach people to construct parallel bars and so that you can walk to the around parts of your yard. So, but there's not a lot. The other thing is people get contractures. So in the early stages, you can teach people to keep moving. But, you know, in some ways, it's not just rehabilitation. It's making people's lives better.
From the vantage point of the 40 years, what have been those kind of most notable changes, that this used to be a huge problem and because of adaptation or changes, it's no longer a problem?
Well, I mean, a lot of the disease, like measles, neonatal tetanus, you know, a lot of those diseases that were killing people when I first came to Mozambique have really gone gone right down because of vaccination. So that's been a change. I mean, our infant mortality and child mortality has fallen. But HIV/AIDS casts such a shadow over everything that it nullifies a lot of the other improvements, I think. But yeah, so we've seen changes in the disease pattern. In the cities, there's more high blood pressure, diabetes.
People being educated with HIV/AIDS in general, do the average person on the street understand the situation?
Oh, yes, yeah. I don't know about the remoter rural areas, but certainly in a city like Maputo, people understand. And everybody's got family with HIV. So people really, they understand.
How close do you think it's getting to be that people can feel like it's a disease that people will live with?
Oh, that's there already.
It's there.
It's there already. So common. People with it are
living
normal lives.
So,
you know, I think everybody has family members or they know people. No, that's happened. It really has.
So that suggests that they are getting access to medication. Right?
Yes, yes. No, they are. But I'm talking about the cities, you know, where people do have access.
So out more in the rural areas is where there's less access.
Yes.
And probably less.
And there's less HIV.
There's less HIV also.
Yes, yeah. Well, it depends on the rural area.
Right.
Like the ones where miners are coming back from South